All right, so today with Raffaele Savelli, tell us about probing seven brains on orbifolds. Take it away.
Thanks a lot, Julius. And thank you very much for having me at the Quiver meeting. It's a pleasure for me to speak, and also I'm grateful for the opportunity you give me. So the talk of today, it's based on a work that I've recently written in collaboration with Simone and Marina. They should both be in the audience now. I'm not able to see everyone, but okay, they told me that they will join. So the talk is based on this work, and I will be basically talking about an old subject, which is the field theory living at low energy on the wall volume of D3 brains, probing stacks of parallel general seven brains. So by seven brains, since I don't put the D, means general seven brains, either non-perturbative. Actually, that would be the core of the work. And this is, of course, an old subject, but still some details, I mean, some specific configurations of this basic setting were not completely explored in the literature, despite the age of the subject. And this is essentially because of the lack of techniques able to probe, to give the details of field theories which are intrinsically strongly coupled. So having said that, of course, in the realm of perturbative string theory and perturbative field theory, everything is basically very well known. But when it comes to, we have seven brains, so they admit a generalization to non-perturbative. And so when it comes to non-perturbative stacks of seven brains, the story here, it was known only when the stack is wrapping basically a smooth space, but already for the most easy singular space like C2 mod Z2, the details were not known. So the aim of this talk is to try to shed light on this subject of non-perturbative seven brains on orbifolds. And I will only touch upon abelian orbifolds. So that's the subject. But for doing that, of course, I will attack this problem using the technique of quiver of magnetic quivers, which of course you very well know, and it's thanks to your work, to Amis group in particular, that have contributed a lot to develop this technique, that we can actually say something about these theories. But I will also try during this talk to keep as much as possible our old intuition, basically based on fractional brains, fractional D3 brains in particular. So I will try to keep this intuition as much as possible in front of us so that the generalization to non-perturbative will be kind of more digestible, at least in my opinion, than we can see. But so I will be focusing always on the fractional brain story. And for this reason, I will have a long introduction on a subject which is already known, which is seven brains of the perturbative type, namely the SO8 stack, wrapping orbifolds, abelian orbifolds. So although this subject is very well known, but I will try to reformulate in a way that then the generalization to non-perturbative will be kind of straightforward or very natural, at least in my opinion. Okay, so please interrupt me whenever you want for any questions or comments or suggestions or whatever. Okay, so can you see the pointer? Yes, okay. So the subject is, okay, so we want to have n D3 brains in the vicinity of a stack of parallel seven brains. And here is a picture, not so nice picture. The theory living on the D3 brain is, of course, well known to be n equal to 2 field theory in four dimensions. And we are going to focus in particular on theories which have a superconformal symmetry. And if you require superconformal symmetry, a necessary condition for that, necessary and not in general sufficient, is that there is no back reaction on the axial dilaton of type 2B. So the seven brains that you are going to consider, I mean, there is a restricted choice of them because they don't have to back react on the axial dilaton. It's basically, we have to focus on F theory on constant tau backgrounds. And in particular, not only that, I will focus in particular on those local K3 backgrounds which have an orbifold limit. So these all these restrictions tell me that I really have a handful of cases, which are like these cases, C times T2 mod Z delta 7, and this number just classifies this this handful of cases as it is well known. Delta 7 is a number, okay, its quantity, its values is 2, 3, 4, and 6, as it is well known. And delta 7 tells you what's the basically the periodicity of the transverse coordinate transverse to the 7 brain. I remember that for me, Z1 and Z2 are the longitudinal 7 brain coordinates, and Z3 is the transverse one. So delta 7 determines the periodicity of the phase of Z3. And not only that, it is an important quantity because it is also determining the Coulomb branch dimensions, the dimensions of the Coulomb branch operator of the field theory on the D3 brain. In particular, they will be multiples, integral multiples of delta 7. An extremely important statement for us for the following, for what I'm going to discuss, is that so we know that D3 brains are blind to the SL2Z of F theory. And this very reason tells us that whenever we have a quotient of this type, and so this is the F theory quotient, the D3 brains we have, I mean, for every D3 brain that probe D3 brain that we consider, there are basically K copies of, delta 7 copies of, there will be also K, which is the orbifold thing, but now there will be delta 7 copies of delta 3. So think about of D3 brains. Think about the orientifold. The orientifold is the case where delta 7 is equal to 2. We have a D3 brain and its image D3 brain. When there is a generalization, non-perturbable generalization of the orientifold, which for me is going to be E6, E7, E8, there are going to be respectively for each D3 brain, 3 copies of it, 4 copies, and 6 copies acted upon by Z delta 7. So this statement is kind of trivial, but it is going to be important. Okay, so as I said, these are the 4 cases. The only perturbative, completely well-known case is the case of the so-called SO8 stack, which involves 4D7. For image D7, which I call D7 prime, and the orientifold O7 minus. Questions or comments? Well, I will fly over these things because it's really very basic. Of course, before going to the orbifold, let me just fly over the smooth case. So consider 7 brains over the smooth manifold, the C2. And start with the perturbative case, which is D4. And this is the very well-known theory, which is a USP2N theory. N is the number of probes, without counting the images, if you want, 2N, if you want to count the orientifold image. And then there is SO8 flavor symmetry. And the Coulomb branch direction is basically the relative motion of the D3 with respect to its orientifold image. In fact, there is the orientifold in between, the O7 here. So specular movements of D3 and D3 prime just determines the Coulomb branch direction. And in the exact same story, but simply with more than 2 D3 brains, it works the non-perturbative cases. So E6, E7, E8, they generate the very famous and celebrated Minna-Nemeshansky theories at rank N. And the Coulomb branch motions are is basically relative motions. Instead now being 2 D3 brains, there are 3, 4, and 6 according to the case. Okay, so, and this generates the fact that in all these cases, the Coulomb branch, as I was advertising before, the Coulomb branch dimensions, operator dimension, are multiple of this delta 7. The theory has rank N, so there is for every little N from 1 to N, these are the dimensions. Okay, very well known. And now let's go to the case of the orbifold. Let's now put the seven brain stack on a 4-dimensional orbifold, which is for us only abelian, C2 mod ZK. The ZK acts on the coordinates like this. Z1 goes to A to the 2 pi I divided by K, and Z2 e to the minus 2 pi I divided by k. This is, of course, this Calabi-Yau action. So to keep supersymmetry to 8 supercharges. Now, As before for the Z Delta 7, once you take one D3, one probe D3 brain that go and hits the singularity which is located at the origin of this C2 space, then it fractionates, it's very well known, in K copies of it, which we call fractional D3 brains, and they are in correspondence, in one-to-one correspondence, with the irreducible representations of the orbifold group, which is in this case ZK. And since it is a particularly easy case, we can put this irreducible representation in one-to-one correspondence with the kth roots of one of unity. And in particular, picture them in a graph. I mean, it will be very useful for us to keep this k-gon, this regular polygon with k vertices in mind, because we will do many things with this k-gon, with this regular polygon. In general, okay, so now to proceed and to see what the field theory is on the probe, we must specify how the orbifold group acts on the Champaton space of this fractional D3 brains, because now the Champaton space is basically enlarged from one D3 brain probe, you get K of them, or Kn of them if they were n before. So this in this enlarged Champaton space, you have to say how the orbifold action is. So what's the orbifold action? And in full generality, if you have a general orbifold group, not necessarily ZK, if you have a regular integral D3 brain that splits, the representation that tells you how the G orbifold acts is the so-called regular representation of a finite group. The regular representation is just this direct sum of the irreducible representation elevated to the dimension of such a irreducible representation. So now to make things easy, so since we are really doing the easiest case, which is ZK, this is the orbifold action in this case, because so the orbifold action, so in this case, all the irreducible representation of ZK are one dimensional, it's an abelian group. I have to just put all of them in the diagonal, and this is the result. Basically. So these are the irreducible representation, all the K irreducible representations of ZK. And I have also put here a tensor IN, because I am allowing the possibility of having N D3 brains instead of one fractionating. Okay, so that's one way of distributing the fractional brains among the various irreducible representations of the orbifold group. So this is not just one way. It is basically the most quote-unquote canonical way of distributing is the only, the unique homogeneous distribution of fractional D3 brains. So all the other distributions that are possible are always inhomogeneous in the sense that you're going to have unpaired fractional D3 brains somewhere for some irreducible representation. So this is, so what so we call, so the field theory corresponding to this these homogeneous configurations are going to play a very important role for us. And they have played an important role in the paper. That's why for us, they deserve the name. We call them the canonical theories. I'm not sure this name is good enough, but anyway. So the canonical theories for me would be the theories the associated field theories corresponding to configuration of fractional D3 brains, which are totally homogeneous. So I really put the same number of D3 brains, fractional D3 brains for every reducible representation of the orbital. I will elucidate the many properties of these canonical theories as I go on in the talk, and you will see also from the point of view of magnetic quiver what it means to have canonical theories with respect to non-canonical. But okay, now it's a bit too early. But I mean, this is the name, these are the most important family of theories that we will have. As I was advertising, more general configurations, more general distributions of fractional D3 brains are of course possible. And the most general one is when you choose for each D3, for each irreducible representation of the orbifold group, you decide how many fractional brains you want to put. So it basically boils down to a choice of a collection of K numbers, this what I call here NP, P from 0 to K minus 1. This tells you how many fractional D3 brains you want to put for every irreducible representation. And since we are having flavor brains as well, you have to do the same thing for these seven brains. And I just put the name MP instead of NP just to distinguish that these are the seven brains for each reducible representation. So since we want to have only superconformal field theories, we want to restrict attention to that. we don't, you cannot do whatever you want. The choice of NP and MP are highly constrained by conformal invariance, in the sense that you have to kill the beta function for every gauge group, and then this constrains a lot the choice of these numbers. But still, you get some choice. I'm going too slow on these basic things. So please give me feedback if you are bored or anything, questions or comments.
It's good.
Thanks. Okay, so now, so that we have specified the orbifold action, so once you have this matrix gamma 3 and also gamma 7 for the 7 brain, then this is the behavior of the gauge field on the D3 brain. And then there are three scalars on the D3 brain, phi 3, which behaves as the gauge field. Remember, we have n equal to 2, so we want to, so there is a scalar in the vector multiplet. And then instead, phi 1 and phi 2 behave differently with respect to the gauge field and phi 3, and they form an hypermultiplet. So these guys behave this way, and the orbifold invariant configuration behave this way, and this generate a gauge group of this type. Very famous, it's a split of unitary gauge groups, and the hypermultiplets behave this way. The 2 is a bit cancelled, 2 pi I divided by k, and this is for the hypermultiplet. So this means that we get a picture of this type, okay, where we have gauge groups for each unitary gauge groups for every vertex, and then there are the bifundamental fields, which are these guys here. And then I have not drawn the flavor, but you can do the same thing for the flavors. And you see that there are hypermultiplets going from one fractional stack to one fractional stack of D7 brain space. That are the fundamental hypers that I have not drawn in this picture. Okay. Now, a very important, quite important statement, even though it's a very trivial one, but it is important for us later. When we orientifold, is the fact that gamma 3 is not completely well defined, in the sense that it has an ambiguity. Even though you choose all the NPs, so all the numbers for each irreducible representation of D3 brains that you want to have, there is still an ambiguity that is, of course, very clear. The nature of this ambiguity is very clear. It's you are always free to relabel your irreducible representation, and then you send gamma 3 to this phase. I mean, there is a phase shift of gamma 3 that, of course, affects nothing in the physics. It's just a relabeling of your irreducible representation. And on the level of the regular polygon here, it just rotates by 2 pi p divided by k. Okay, so this is going to be, it's a trivial statement, but it's important immediately now. And now, after this introduction, let's orientifold this story. So we have now an orbifold. We have constructed the orbifold invariant field theory. And now we want to add an extra projection, which is, now let's start with the orientifold, so Z2 projection. Okay, but this projection is not just, as we know very well, it's not just a geometric projection. It's also involving some orientation reversing of the worksheet, which will play a crucial role, of course, here. We have to first ask the following question. What is, in order to project with this orientifold, we have to ask how is this orientifold action acts on the Champaton space? The same thing as we asked before, how the orbifold acts on the Champaton space. So this action, we call it omega 3. Of course, there will be another action of omega 7 for the 7 brain. But once we specify omega 3, omega 7 is given, because the orientifold type O7 minus tells you, given omega 3, how omega 7 behaves. I'm not going to talk about omega 7, but just focus on this. So now, really, the question we are asking ourselves is, what are the allowed choice of omega 3? So first of all, what is omega 3? So omega 3 is determined by how D3 brains, fractional D3 brains, are distributed in this picture with respect to their D3 brain images. So remember that now I have fractional D3 brains for every vertex. But now for every fractional D3 brain, there is going to be the D3 brain prime, the orientifold image of the D3 brain, for every fractional D3 brain that I have in each irreducible representation. So how D3 brain and D3 brain prime are placed in these vertices determine what omega 3 is. And in particular, so this means that I have to tell you, what omega-3 is, I have to tell you what are the vertices that stay fixed under the orienting fold, and what are the vertices that are going to be exchanged under the orienting fold. If they stay fixed, it means that the D3' and D3' stay in the same vertex, otherwise they are going to be exchanged. Some vertices are going to be exchanged. Okay, so this turns into, of course, a purely mathematical question in the sense that, so in order to understand what are the allowed choices of omega-3, we have to take into account the symmetries of this polygon in the way I'm going to say now in the moment. First, let me say that once we specify omega-3, the action on the gauge field of the D3' on the phi-3, they always go together, of course, it is this, with this important minus sign, and then the action on the other guys that go that give you the hypermultiple is this other one. And the most important thing of these two equations is this transpose.
So, Raffaele,
yes.
What is the action on the target space of the orienting folding?
Of the orienting folding, it is Z3 goes into minus Z3. It is an O7 minus standing in Z3 equal to zero.
Sorry, I forgot your coordinates. So your type 2b is on C2 mod Z2, basically.
Yeah, let me go to the beginning. type 2b is on, yeah, if you want C2 mod Z2. I have 47 image placed on Z3 equal to zero, the last two coordinates, and an orienting fold on top of them.
Yeah. So the
orienting fold.
The orbifold goes along Z1, Z2.
You are asking about the orbifold. Yeah, sorry. The orbifold is along Z1 and Z2. The orienting fold is as a transverse space, which is just Z3.
Okay, so it leaves the whole orbifold in invariant, point-wise invariant. So the orienting fold wraps the whole orbifold, so to speak.
The orienting fold wraps the whole world like the seven brains.
Okay, so each fractional D3 is already on top of the O plane.
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Well, okay, but then when you describe the Coulomb branch, they split, no, in a...
Okay, and you're saying you have the freedom on each node to choose a different lift to the Champeyton?
No. So I have fractional D3 brains distributed of each vertex, but then to tell you what is the orienting fold action, I have to tell you how the D3 brain image are distributed with respect to the D3. And now I will tell you what are the allowed...
Okay.
It's basically going to be a reflection of the polygon now if you want to jump.
Then it means that each fractional brain is not already invariant by
itself. It doesn't need to be. I mean, there may be some and there may be others that instead are the vertices are exchanged.
Okay. But that means that the orientable plane doesn't wrap the whole resolution, the whole result.
The resolution? No, sorry. I was talking about the
okay. So it wraps the orbifold, but after resolution, it
after the resolution, it doesn't need to.
Okay. I see. Okay.
The C2 mod Z2 is wrapped, but in the resolution phase.
Okay.
Right. There are things that can be exchanged. But now I will describe the allowed possibility because not everything can be done.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
What is that can be done? So as I was saying here, the most important thing is this transpose, which is, of course, due to the fact that the worksheet is the orientation of the worksheet is reversed. But how do I understand what are the omega trees that are allowed? So there is a very stupid and natural condition to require is that if I take my field theory that before orienting folding and orbifolding, and I first orbifold and then I orienting fold it, or vice versa, it should not change. I mean, I should get the same theory whether I first do one projection and then the other on the fields, right? So this very, very condition here, due to the fact that I have this transpose when I orienting fold, it yields this important condition on the matrices omega 3 and gamma 3 that act on the Champaton space. So you would say, okay, this condition means that omega 3 and gamma 3 commute. No, they don't commute because of this transpose. They commute up to an inverse. So basically, if I do the orienting fold gamma 3 and the orienting fold minus 1, which this minus 1 is useless, of course, it's an involution, then this means making the orbifold projection inverse. Okay, so they commute up to an inverse. But this, probably I said it too many words for a simple fact, but this has an important consequence, and the consequence is that the structure of the Orbi-Orientifold group is not a stupid structure of the product of the Orbifold group and the Orientifold group, Z2, but it is some sort of twisted, I don't know how to call it. Sorry, there is a way to call it. It's a semi-direct product of ZK and Z2. ZK is the Orbifold group, and Z2 is the Orientifold group, if you want. And then the Z2 acts non-trivially on ZK by inverting the transformation of ZK, which is this. Okay. So this group, as a name, is the dihedral group of order 2k. I mean, the dk has order 2k, has a 2k dimension. So this group is nothing but, from the point of view of the regular polygon, is nothing but the symmetry group of this polygon. It's the group that makes all the transformation that leave invariant this polygon, which are not just rotations, which are the orbifold group, but are reflection as well. And now the mathematics of this subject tells us already the answer that we wanted. How many of these reflections of these orientifold actions are there that are inequivalent? Well, what does it mean inequivalent? I mean, equivalent, so two orientifold actions are equivalent if I can go from one another by just replacing or relabeling my irreducible representation. So if I basically can send one orientifold projection to another by rotating this polygon, I don't regard this orientifold projection as inequivalent. Okay, so mathematically speaking, what we are really asking is how many conjugacy classes of reflections I have in my dihedral group DK. It's a very well-known fact that when the number here k, the orbifold number, is odd, there is only one conjugacy class, and when the k is even, there are two. So this is very, very easy to picture. So why? So if you take a polygon, so the reflection is always a reflection with respect to some axis. So in a polygon which has odd number of vertices, there is an axis that always passes through a vertex and through the edge in front of the vertex. So there is also going to be like a vertex which is fixed by the orientifold, and the others are basically exchanged among themselves. If instead the polygon has an even number of edges or vertices, then there are two types of axes. One is that passes through two vertices which are in front of each other, and so it has two fixed vertices. Instead, there is another set of axes that instead passes through no vertices, just edges, cuts two edges in half, and these are two inequivalent type of reflections, and that's the two. Okay, good. So sorry if this bothers you. Since I don't see your faces, you may be very well bored by this thing. But this is, I think, very important in light of the non-perturbative generalization, because this pattern, we are going to see it exactly like this, reproduced for the non-perturbative cases E6, E7, E8. There are going to be, for every orbifold order, at least the abelian that we studied, orbifold order, there are going to be either one or two different projections, like the generalization of oriented projection. So E6 projection, E7 projection, or E8 projection. One or two. Well, in that case, it's not according to the parity of K, but it's according to something else. But this phenomenon is reproduced there. Now let me go back to very well-known stuff. Is that once you have seen what are the vertices that are left fixed and what are the vertices that are exchanged, then for every fixed vertex, the gauge group there is going to be the symplectic one, and the flavor group is going to be the orthogonal one, just because I have considered O7 minus. Instead, for the hypermultiplet, of course, you have to, for every field image field pair, you have to keep one of them in the orientifolded or one combination of them in the orientifolded theory. The only exception is when there is a vertex connected by an hyper to the image vertex, which I call vertex prime. In this case, this field becomes antisymmetric because, again, I'm considering the O7 minus. So these are the rules. And now we can go to examples. C2 mod Z2 is the easiest possible. Then in this case, the orbifold group, the orbi-orientifold group is the only possible extension that there is of Z2 by Z2, because inverting in Z2 is doing nothing. So this is the only option. And this tells you that either you can choose this Z2 with the identity here, or you can choose this Z2 with the identity here, no? So you basically consider either the orientifold alone or the orientifold combined with the orbifold. So I'm saying a stupid thing. I'm just saying that either the two vertices in this case are fixed both by the orientifold or they are exchanged. So there are two inequivalent projections. Let me start with the first. The canonical theory. Canonical theory, remember that this was the theory associated to a configuration in which I distributed homogeneously the D3 brain, fractional D3 brains among the various irreducible representations, which in this case are two irreducible representations. And I get this electric quiver, which of course is known. I mean, it appeared already in the literature in several places. The rank of this theory is expected to be twice the rank of the non-orbifolded theory, and the dimension of the Coulomb branches operators are pairs of operators of the same dimension for every little n from 1 to n. Good. Now let me specify, well, although it's already quite clear, but specify some physics of these theories. Of course, if you give VEV to this guy here, what you do, you are basically creating a bound state between the fractional, so the two fractional stacks of D3 brains. So when they bound, they are not anymore able to see the singularity, and they reproduce just an integral D3 brain that is free to move everywhere on the longitudinal space of the 7 brain, but not anymore able to probe the singularity. And of course, it is expected that you go back to the case of no orbifold. Another thing that you can do is to give VEV to these guys here, well, whatever you want. It's a symmetric thing here. If you do that, then you go to another theory, which has, as you can see immediately, a non-homogeneous distribution of fractional D3 brains. You see here 2n minus 2 and 2n here. This, remember, is the number of D3 brains, including the orientifold image. And so this is a different, as I said, is a different choice of gamma 3 and gamma 7, still conformal, everything. So this choice is still compatible with conformality, but it's a non-homogeneous choice. It's a non-canonical theory in our language. And this, in turn, has another way of saying, it's a different choice of holonomy of the 7 brain gauge field at infinity. And so once you have an orbifold, you have to specify, so there is a non-trivial topology at infinity, no? So there are torsional cycles of order k, in this case 2, and you have to tell how is the holonomy, what's the holonomy of the 7 brain gauge field at infinity. Once you specify that, then you will realize what is the flavor symmetry left by unbroken or preserved by this choice.
Raffaele?
Yes.
So you're thinking of this as a moduli space of instantons also?
Yes, there is this option, but in this talk and also in this paper, we have never done so. And you will realize that from the magnetic quiver that I will draw in a moment.
I see.
Because our theories, so that I will always disregard the U1 factor of the unitary gauge groups that I have. And as you know, the U1 factor is always crucial to identify the Higgs branch of these theories with the instanton moduli space for some group, no? But maybe with some abuse of language, I will regard the theories of my D3 brains as the theories without this U1, which is it's an abuse, because I know that the theory on the D3 brain, the UV, has this U1, but in the infrared, the conformal field theory does not have this U1, no? And so the magnetic quiver that I will describe are only containing gauge nodes, as you will see. And in that sense, I'm not thinking about instanton moduli space. I'm not sure whether this answers. Sorry?
I'm fine. Thank you for.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't hear. Okay. So more comments or questions?
Sorry, I had a silly question about the setup. The D7s are wrapping the whole orbifold or a non-compact curve of it?
No. The D7 is on C2 mod ZK.
Okay, it's taking the whole thing. Okay.
Yeah. And transverse to,
one. But what chooses each gauge node attaches to? What chooses what to what gauge node the flavor node attaches?
Okay, so then you have to run. Okay, I was not very detailed on that, but you have to see how the gamma 3 and the gamma 7 matrices act on the various fields and take the invariant one, and this tells you what gauge nodes attach to what flavor node.
Okay. Thanks.
I mean, I've not gone through the details, but I mean, it's a big
no, it's fine. It's fine.
So you'd have a partition problem here, right? You could flavor the one USP, and then you could flavor the other one.
Right? Yeah.
And this will correspond to the choice of boundary conditions.
These ones. Yeah. This partition problem is what I said. It's either homogeneous or not. And the homogeneous partition is the one that is going to play the crucial role here, in the sense that all the other non-homogeneous partitions are always going to be Higgsing of the original homogeneous.
What happens if you take SO2 on the left and SO6 on the right?
That was not possible. If I try to construct this using the standard rules of fractional brains, this choice of numbers is not going to be compatible with conformality.
So, okay, so you insist to have the...
From the beginning, I said I only want to insist on choices of N and M P's that are killing all the beta functions.
Okay.
Of course, more choices are possible if you relax this condition.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, do you have a particular reason for doing so? Like, I mean, of course, conformality is nice, but...
No. The answer is no. It's just because we started from there.
Yeah, okay. That's fair enough. Thanks.
But I'm not sure about the Simone.
Well, if it's not conformal, you may not be able to contract back to the orbifold point, right? Or...
What do you mean? I didn't specify the resolution. I didn't.
Well, you're assuming a resolution, right? Or you're saying this is just equivariant stuff?
It is really equivariant. I'm really working with a regular representation, as you see in the beginning. So it's not. I don't think I am assuming a resolution.
Mm-hmm.
But
the choice of the regular representation ensures conformality.
Wait a moment. So the regular representation is the representation that is at work when you take a regular D3 brain that splits. But this guy here is absolutely not associated to the regular representation.
Okay.
So this guy, you will not be able to extract an integral D3 brain. You can do that, but then there is something left. I mean, there is...
So it's a fractional one.
Yeah, it's an intrinsically fractional.
So how do you know it doesn't cascade or?
I'm going to describe a cascade now, but focus on this theory with a fixed n. So you see that there is unpaired stuff here, no?
Right. Okay. So if you had the resolve thing and you wrap that stuff on it, it's not clear that you would be able to contract it back. So the orbifold, it might deform. Well, with threefolds, we know this happens, right? With the conifold and stuff, that the conifold gets deformed if you wrap a fractional one. I don't know with K3s, but.
I don't know. I mean, I would be curious to see what's the resolution when the configuration is this one. So I'm asking the opposite question, if you want. If I am in the singular space.
Well, I mean, the singular, the resolution, you know what it is. There's only one resolution because it's a K3. You don't have to worry about flops or triangulations.
No, but when I have unpaired D3 brains there are brains stuck at the singularity here. I cannot move them.
Yeah, sure.
So how is that?
Well, you know that all of that has a Sheafy description. Yeah. There's a derived equivalence. So, I mean, it must have an answer, right?
Maybe we can do the sheaf.
Yeah, okay.
Let's do the
I want to get, thanks.
You don't care to go. Okay.
Thanks to the help of you, because otherwise I get completely.
No worries. Let's crack on.
Good. So, let me go on. And different global symmetry. So, this I already said. The cascade. So, now you see, you stay here. I mean, you want to now give web to these guys here. And then you cascade, so you go back basically to the previous homogeneous situation, just with n going to n minus one. And this generates a cascade, or in other words, generates a Hasse diagram for this Higgs branch flow, which has the following shape. Here I just draw the, I mean, I just specify the non-abelian part of the flavor sim. But now, when we stare at this, we immediately see that there is a strange thing going on, because the mathematics tells us that there are three choices of holonomy, so three choices of preserved global symmetries, and not just two. Where is the third? So these are two. The third is U4, according to the theory, and in fact, the second Orentiev projection comes at rescue. The second Orentiev projection, the inequivalent one, just exchanged the two vertices. I don't want to now repeat the same things. So here, one and one prime are the image, you know, the pair of the D3 image, the two and two prime, also. So vertex and vertex image. And the theory is this one. As I was telling to Ami before, I am ignoring the U1. Although I know that the UV theory has this U1. And as a consequence, this engaging, as a consequence of the global symmetry of the theory, that it just adds an extra U1, which you should not have. And in fact, all our magnetic weavers dual to this will have all these extra topological symmetries, which translate into flavor symmetries of the original theory. So the Hasse diagram here is easier, always with this U4. A global symmetry, and just the gauge group becomes even, odd, etc., etc. Quickly, very quickly, before going to magnetic weaver, the C2 mod Z3 case, in this case, there is only one option. It's a triangle. It's the group of triangles, of regular, so what's called equilateral triangle. And also there is a vertex which is just left and fixed by the Orentiev, then two are exchanged. So in this case, the canonical theory, so the homogeneous distribution, is this theory here. Again, I have forgotten the U1 here, forgotten, I mean, neglected the U1. And there is a mistake, of course, there is an anti-symmetric guy here that I forgot.
Rafael, you know that the Hasse diagram is very problematic in this case.
It's very problematic when I forget the U1, you mean? Or what?
Not even. It's very problematic just because you're dealing with modular spaces of instances.
It's okay.
You are subtracting the slices which are the same, and you have to take symmetry factors. And, non-normal components, and it's really a whole mess.
So you say I should not trust these Hasse diagrams?
But I think it's fine. This is just, these are very specific Higgs things. It's a neat path. I think we should view it like that.
Yeah,
we can discuss
it. Only partial Higgs.
Yeah, so, exactly. These are partial Higgs things.
These are partial Higgs things. That's true. Yeah.
And the point is that it will be very difficult to identify all possible Higgs. In the
no, okay. I can imagine. I can only imagine, in the sense that we have not gone through this. I mean, this was not really the aim. No.
I see.
But,
okay.
Yeah, but of course, it's a possible direction to explore. But I have unfortunately not much to say about that. About this, the leaf structure of these Higgs branches.
Okay.
I have nothing to say. Yeah.
Thank you.
So these are the easiest possible type of Higgsing that you can think of. And as Julius was saying, it's partial.
Okay.
More comments or questions? So here, okay. Let me go quickly to Z4. Z4 is the group of the square.
And the group of the square, well, has two possible realization, and either the two fixed vertices or no fixed vertex, which is a reflection to this axis with respect to this axis. And there are two canonical theories according to which reflection you take, and two Higgs branch flows, two Hasse diagrams, two everything, two copies of everything. There are inequivalent things.
And there's an antisymmetric on the SU?
In this case, no.
No.
No. In this case, no. In the previous case, yes, because there was an hypermultiple connecting.
I understand. Sorry. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, you would have it if there was an hypermultiple going like that, but there is not such a thing.
Yep.
This is Z4, right?
This is Z4, yeah. But that's the last, I promise it's the last one. Now I go to magnetic fields. So let me now, okay. So the route to generalizing this to non-perturbative is to try and reinterpret all of what I said, that was very well known, in the language of magnetic fields. And you will see the pattern emerging very naturally, which will be the door for us to generalize. C2 mod Z2 again, revisited. No, so this was the electric quiver. The magnetic quiver is this one. And okay, I'm not going through the details of how you identify this to be the mirror image of this quiver, but just focus on the global symmetries. That is probably the quickest way to see why this is the mirror quiver, and this has the same global symmetries as this one. Well, there is an extra U1 due to this guy, which is the associated to the bifundamental, but otherwise there is the global symmetry left unbroken by this choice of holonomy. But then I want you to focus on the fact that this quiver has an abelian node, so it is basically the Dynkin diagram of SO8, the extended Dynkin diagram of SO8, this, and the central one, plus an additional one attached to the central node. And the central node has comark 2. And these two should ring you a bell that we are on Z2. Okay, so then we will see what's the rule, the general rule. But okay, now I just say that. Here I have I wanted to pause and to make a digression, which I will probably skip because I am going out of time, about what is the very important feature of canonical magnetic quivers, namely magnetic quivers associated to what I call the canonical theory. I just say that they are given, so they really specific, their property is the fact that the weight corresponding to every node is n times, n is just the number of integral probe brains that I originally have, times the comark of that node. So this is not true if I don't consider the canonical theory. But in the canonical theory, this property is correct. Another way of saying this is that this weight vector is in the kernel. So if you take the Cartan matrix, the extended Cartan matrix of the theory of the flavor symmetry here, of course, this as a kernel, no, it's not it's equal to zero determinant, and the kernel so this Wi constructed in this way is exactly in this kernel. So this statement now for the expert, it's a very important statement to connect the holonomy at zero of the seven brain cage field and the holonomy at infinity of this seven brain cage field. In other words, it tells you something about the curvature of the instanton bundle. So just to summarize, maybe this is a comment only for the expert, but integral D3 brains, they don't contribute to the curvature. They don't change the curvature. They just shift the second chair class of the bundle, so the instanton. So this N is basically the only freedom that is there. But once you have, so that's the importance of purely fractional D3 brains, namely those that are really stuck at the singularity. Those really create a curvature of the instanton bundle. And therefore make a difference between the holonomy at zero and the holonomy at infinity of the gauge field. But the canonical theories are so canonical that the connection of the bundle is flat. And so whether I call instant holonomy at zero or infinity doesn't matter, it's the same. As I said, the canonical theories are stemming out of our description, and the non-canonical ones, we are obtaining them from Higgsing those canonical. And the Higgs thing we do is through this technique, which I learned from the Simone's patience in explaining all these techniques related to magnetic weavers, which I appreciated a lot. And I still am in the process of learning these things. So how you implement at the level of magnetic weavers, the Higgsing is through the technique of quiver subtraction, and that's what we do to construct this non-canonical theory starting from the canonical one. But let me now go to the second canonical, because as I said, for Z2, there are two canonical theories. The first one was obtained by attaching a one here at the comark 2. Instead, if I take two ones and I attach to guys that have a comark 1, it's like I'm doing again a Z2. So 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, or 2 plus 0 is equal to 2. So that's the rule that now we will see in other examples. So for making a Z2 projection, I either have to attach an abelian node here, or two abelian nodes here and here. So that the sum is.
You know the connection of the Quartz classification of embeddings of the.
Yeah, it is a very reminiscent of. It's basically very reminiscent. There is it's not a coincidence, of course. All these things, as I will try to explain in the very last few minutes, come from an M theory dual version of it, in which this rule is applied for the magnetic weavers of the 6D or B instanton theories. But okay, it's basically the same rule. There is only a caveat here that it's again the same caveat I'm going over and over, and to answer to one of Ami's question is that I am not considering quivers of this type. So if you would think of the Higgs branches as instanton moduli space, you will be forced to focus on quivers of this type, which are basically the same as quivers of this type, but not quite, because in this case I am abelian. I have a gauge abelian nodes in this case. Not, of course, if it is only one U1, that doesn't matter, because in a flavorless quiver, one node you can always translate. I mean, there is always one combination of U1 that doesn't act on anything, so it is either a square or a round. It doesn't matter. But if there is more than one, then it does matter. I mean, it changes completely the theory, no? So this is a different thing than this. But as I said, by abusing the language, I'm saying, okay, the theory of my D3 brain is dual to this theory. Let me run to the Z3 story. The Z3 story, as you can see, there is one canonical theory only. And as you can see, the one is attached here and here. There is no more option. So the fact is that, so there is only one theory. So we only have to get one. And in fact, there is no other option. Okay, you immediately say, why don't you consider one here, one here, one here? So you involve more than two tails of the SO8 Dynkin diagram. Okay, if you do that, you necessarily go non-perturbative. So you get non-perturbative elective theories. I'm not going to give you details about that because I'm out of time, but this is really something, it's a very special thing that really concerns only the SO8 Dynkin diagram, which is particularly symmetric. So in that case, you can consider more than two tails. But if you do, you go to non-perturbative. So the original orbi-orientable theories that I constructed perturbatively are following the rules I'm saying, either two or one projection. And this is the pattern that we will now discover for the non-perturbative cases. C2 mod Z4 has these two cases only, as we expect, because there were two cases before. General rules, and then I will give some examples for non-perturbative. General rules, so I want to construct the canonical theory for a given projection. I consider n D3 brains probing a G stack of 7 brains on the orbifold, abelian orbifold C2 mod ZK. The canonical theory is constructed in this way. You first consider the affine Dynkin diagram of your G thing. And then you attach abelian nodes, abelian gauge nodes, with just a single bond, single link, to nodes that have a comark such that, I mean, there are two conditions to be satisfied. You want a star-shaped quiver, just because we wanted to focus on conformal field theories. And you want the sum of these guys to be k, because k is the order of the original one. And then you get as many canonical theories as inequivalent ways of attaching these ones. The rank of the theory by construction, we have noticed that it is this number. It is the expected rank, k times n. And then you would expect that this is zero because the expected rank is k times n, but it is not zero. Well, because of the nodes that we are attaching, there are extra abelian nodes that we are attaching. So there is a correction factor of this L. L is the number of nodes that you attach. The Coulomb branch operator dimensions is going to be k n blocks of k entries each. And then the last block has the highest n minus one entries eliminated. Okay, I'm not going to say any details about that because at this point it becomes quite technical. And all the other non-canonical theories are obtained by Hitzing. Okay, let me say some. Do I have 5 minutes?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thanks. So in 5 minutes, I'll try to give some examples of now really non-perturbative theories after this very long introduction of perturbative cases. So let's start with E6. In this case, there is only one projection. And in fact, if you take the E6 Dinkin diagram, extended E6 Dinkin diagram, the only option that you have is to attach one here and one here. And you are attaching the two ones to two nodes of Comarch 1. So 1 plus 1 is 2. And you cannot do anything else because there is a 3 here. So remember that you want a star-shaped quiver because we want to focus on conformal theories. If you want to give up conformality, of course, you can take this guy, one guy, and attach here. And then you get Z2 theory. I mean, C2 mod Z2, A6 on C2 mod Z2, but it's not going to be conformal. Good. But now let me go back to fractional base because I wanted to keep this intuition of fractional base always manifest. And this is very expected that you would get only one thing, only one theory. So remember now you have Z2. So you have two vertices, the two vertices being this one. And the only option to distribute the fractional D3 brains is to consider both the vertices fixed now by what is the generalization of the orientifold, which is Z3. E6 generalized the orientifold to Z3. No, remember Z delta 7. In this case, Z delta 7 is Z3. So one prime and one double prime are the images under this Z3. And both these vertices are fixed by this Z3. So it is very tempting, although at this point is still just a speculation, it is very tempting to speculate that the actual mathematical structure behind this story is like the group under which you have to project, like the generalization of the Orbi orientifold to non-perturbative, is a particular extension of the orbifold. Mathematically, one say of this Z delta 7, the F theory group, say by the orbifold group. Okay, so this was the case for the perturbative situation. So DK is a very special extension, is called the split extension of Z2, the orientifold group, by the orbifold group. Of course, speculating even more, I can do any ADE orbifold and I can just substitute this with any ADE. Well, this is A, any D and E. Okay. And the structure should remain the same. So identifying this structure should tell you, ideally, how many possibilities you have. And so far we have found either one or two. In the sense that you have to see how many conjugacies classes of embedding of this guy into this guy there are. Okay, and then this tells you how many possibilities that are inequivalent you have. And ideally, this structure should tell you also something about what is the Coulomb branch spectrum of the theory and stuff like that. I mean, it's some invariant of this object. We are not at that level. We are probably far. But for k equal to 2 and delta 7 equal to t, the only option that you have, is the trivial extension. And in fact, the trivial extension is totally in line with the fact that you have only one conjugacy class of this Z3 inside G. It's this conjugacy class. E is the identity of Z2, and G is the generator of the other guy. Same structure, similar structure, but different conclusion for E6 on Z3. Now you have two realizations, and this is because you have this quiver where, you attach the one here at the node with Comarch 3, And otherwise, you attach three ones at the nodes of Comarc 1. 1 plus 1, 1 plus 1 is 3. Again, this is compatible with the fact that the group, the group by which you have two quotient is again a direct product, and that's the only possibility. E7 on Z2 works the same way. There are two projections, and this is compatible with this choice of the group. The two things are when you attach the node here, or the nodes at the tails here, left and right. And finally, I want to conclude with the case of E8. That's really the last subject, which takes 2 minutes. Sorry. So E8 on C2 mod Z2. I want to go in some more details about this E8 on C2 mod Z2, just because this is really very simple in a simple way and direct way. Can be gotten from M theory, from the dual M theory perspective, which is actually the way we derived all our rules. So I gave you a very hand-wavy way of guessing what are the general rules to construct these magnetic weavers, but then we actually derive this way of proceeding by known quivers existing for 6D Orbi instanton theories. And that's the very last thing I want to say. In this situation, C2 mod Z2, there is only one canonical theory. The only option, as you can see from the Dinkin diagram of E8, is attaching the one to the two here. The rank is as expected. It's only one U1 that you have attached. And the Coulomb branch dimensions is this. Anyway, the asset diagram, but this.
Rafael, what about the two other cases where you attach one on the 2N guy on the right, on the left?
You want to attach the one here. Here you want to attach.
Yeah.
No, here, okay, so you can, but then you have to give up conformality.
And why you don't give up
conformality? No, there is no answer for it. I mean,
in the first case that you consider, what you have currently, why you say that you don't give up conformality?
In this case, I get a star-shaped quiver.
Oh. You insist on having a star shape?
Yeah. This was my first rule. Yeah, I want to attach once so that there is this sum rule, and then always sticking with star shape weavers.
Okay, so how about adding two on the leftmost node?
Okay, so this is a very good question that I have not specified. You are saying why I don't attach multiple times to the same. So as I said before, it's like the Katz rule, but not quite. So we are not allowing, in that case, it would also be not star-shaped, right? So you are saying now.
Why not?
So you say this one.
Yeah, not two of them, just one node of two.
One node with the double bond. Yes, yeah. that's the very good question, which I don't tell you why we don't do that. But we don't do that because, I mean, we also wrote in the paper. Also, in this case, we have seen that this leads to non-conformal theories. Also the double bond, the double link. So you are saying basically this thing.
I see.
The double link also leads you to non-conformal theories. But it's not easy.
What about the one bond, but node number two?
One like this?
No. The leftmost node.
Sorry, one like this, you said?
Yes, no edge multiplicity and node number two.
And no, but this is three. I mean, 2 plus 1 is 3. So in this way, I would construct E8 over C2 mod Z3.
No, I mean, you don't have the rightmost guy.
Ah, you don't have this right, okay.
Yeah. How about this option? Is this a viable option?
Okay, so let me try to understand what's the option. So you are saying I attach one here, and what else?
And node number two.
Here.
No. The leftmost node has one single node.
Attached. With the two.
He wants the non-abelian node.
Sorry, I didn't understand. Okay. The non-abelian node we have also not tried.
We have only tried with abelian nodes. I don't know the answer. I don't know what would you get in this. Do you know, Simone, or what do you expect about that?
I don't know if this is related to different brains. If you touch non-abelian nodes, I'm not sure.
Okay. Maybe we can come back to that later to the in the discussion. Let me just conclude this because I really don't want to. So from M theory, you can derive this theory very easily. You just exploit the duality with M5 brains that are now wrapped on T2 in order to take the F theory duality to type 2B, no? With the L reduction and T duality. And then the M5 probes and M9 wall that is wrapped on the same orbital. And here, the very important point of this picture is that the flavor symmetry is made of two things. One that you expect, which is the holonomy preserved by holonomy, the thing that is preserved by holonomy from E8. And then there is an extra piece that you don't expect from type 2B. This extra piece is the geometric engineering, the geometric engineered gauge symmetry, which is a flavor symmetry in this case, that is engineered from the singularity, not of M theory. And this is not seen in type 2B. It means that the duality map between these two pictures has to involve a way of breaking this SUK. And this way of breaking is by a mass deformation. There is a very handy way that I learned from Simone to do that. That's at the level of magnetic quivers, which is the only thing that we have in these non-perturbative situations. And this is by turning on Fayad-Yapov terms. But the only thing that I wanted to highlight, and I conclude, is that the Hasse diagrams that we were finding in type 2B are totally reproduced here in these Orbi instanton theories, just because these Hasse diagrams involved Higgsings of part of the flavor symmetry in H that commutes with SUK. So basically, we find a completely mirrored or a copy of the Hasse diagram that we found in type 2B at the level of M theory, just with different type of quivers, because all these quivers are of this shape. And they involve a tail, which just encodes the SU2, in this case, a symmetry, geometric symmetry. So by Higgs, as I said, by turning Fayad-Yapov terms for this tail, you can connect from the two pictures, between the two pictures. And you treat E7 and E6, and we did it in the paper by deforming, combining deformation of both the E8 and the SUK. Okay, this is the conclusion. Well, just one slide of outlook. What I really find most intriguing, at least in my opinion, is this structure here. Is this really making sense? I mean, is this structure really relevant for what we have been saying in this talk? This is not clear. And if it is, can we use it to do something, or namely to predict the properties of the field theories, like the Coulomb branch spectrum and stuff like that, by geometric invariance of this guy here? And something that we also are exploring at the moment with Simone is to go to n=1 type of configuration. So maybe, so taking non-Calabi-Yau projections of the or volume of the 7 brain. Okay, thank you, and sorry for being so late.
All right, let's thank Raffaele.
Thanks.
Questions?
Thank you here.
Raffaele.
Yes.
So in the strictly AN case, we know that if you're at the orbifold point, you can have anti-brains coexist with brains, right? So the fact that you had the necklace quiver, the affine node is an anti, it's an anti-brain wrapping all of the exceptional curves, if we look at it from that way. Right, so your fractional D3s are really D5s wrapping various spheres.
Okay, I agree. Yeah.
The extra node that closes the circle is an anti-D5 wrapping all of them. and they can coexist. And this is known that if the B field is right and you're at the orbifold point, it can coexist. And I suppose also with your D7 brain.
Okay, this is the orbifold picture. When you orientifold it.
I suppose even that might be okay. My question is, when you have now an eight type seven brain, you know, God knows what's happening in string theory. You don't know how to compute central charges and make sure that the whole thing is mutually BPS. I don't know if the fact that it's a K3 instead of a Calabi-Yau threefold saves the day, but I'm curious, like, you know, how do you know that these brains can coexist without brain recombination being triggered?
The D3, the fractional D3, you mean?
Well, so you have these fractional D3s. First of all, they have to coexist amongst each other.
Wait a moment.
And coexist with the D7 because they are actually D5.
No, D7, there is no D7 now, though. There is a strange.
Well, there's a strange seven brain.
Yeah, exactly.
In the simple case, it was a D7 coexisting with a bunch of D5s and anti-D5s, which you know that as soon as you would start blowing up the spheres, this would completely break supersymmetry. It would dissolve and whatever. But we know that at the orbifold point with the right choice of B field, it's fine. The central charges all align.
Yeah.
But you're only talking about a single example of the conic fold. Do you have a more general picture?
I'm not talking about the conic fold, though. I'm talking his K3s.
So how many fractional brains do you have?
Well, he has as
many types. How many types of fractional brains?
What do you mean by types? He has D5s and anti-D5s as fractional brains, right?
Only two.
And then these have to coexist with seven brains. So they're, you know.
Wait, Andres, I don't think that this picture is still reproduced for the 678 because, I mean, this having a D5 and anti-D5 is the same thing as when you have the orientifold is having D3 and image D3. Now, what I was telling from the very beginning of the talk is that when you generalize to E6678, being the D3 blind to F theory, to the F theory SL2, for every D3, there are Z delta 7 copies of it.
I'm confused about the, what do you mean blind to the?
D3 brains are trivial under the SL2Z, no?
Yeah, but it's not like you can go to a perturbative frame when you have E8, it's a mixed. When you have an E type seven
brain. No, but that regards the seven brain. From the point of view of the D3, as in the orientifold, you add the image D3. In the E6, you have to add two image in the
seven. It's not the orientifold I worry. It's the fractional brains. Even in
the orbifold, you are saying.
There are five brains.
There are five brains in the resolution, yeah.
And five brains, in that case, can coexist with D7s. Provided you're at the orbifold point, and then that works, and your whole equivariant story works perfectly. It's been checked, but now you don't have D7s. You have, you know, these P comma Q mixtures of seven brains. How does one check that this still coexists with your fractional D3 brains? I don't know if it's enough to invoke the M theory dual picture and say, well, it's going to work out, but. It seems like a tautology because that picture you don't know how to calculate from first principles, except by dualizing. I mean, there's never a perturbative picture, right, where you can check that the fractional brains.
Oh no, that does not exist. No, but it has to. No, for the consistency of the field theory tells you that there must be a way of these to coexist. I don't know.
But there's also a dual. Brain system in the Schwarz five.
Which one?
If you turn the D3 to D4 and the D7 to D6.
Yeah, but he doesn't have D6. I mean, he doesn't. He has a mixture of mutually non-local P comma Q seven brains. That so trying to do a T-duality on this.
Well,
Iñaki wants to tell something about this.
You mean for the ego?
Maybe we can we can see if there are some specific questions for us. And if not, you know, thank him again. Is there any? Okay, so let's think of Hel again.
Thank you.
And let's go off the record.